Welcome, everyone. Good evening. My name is Anne-Marijn Upker, and I am a program editor here at the Balie. Tonight, we are delighted to welcome one of the most famous economists of our time, Mr. Thomas Piketty, who most recently published the book Capital and Ideology and became famous with his book Capital in the 21st Century. We will have a conversation with him and Mr. Lodewijk Asscher this evening. Mr. Lodewijk Asscher is the leader of the Labour Party and is the former Deputy Prime Minister in the Netherlands. He will run for the elections in 2021. And we're really happy that they're both here with us tonight. With both of them, we will look at the question of how we can create a more equal society. We will have a conversation between the theory and practice, and we will look at how we can put Mr. Piketty's theories into practice with an academic, a writer, a scientist, and a politician who knows everything about the political reality. I am very curious to hear what Mr. Asscher would like to hear from Mr. Piketty. What he is a big inspiration, and I'm looking forward to hear what you are going to do with these ideas. And I'm also very curious to hear from Mr. Piketty how he is looking at the social democratic parties in Europe and in the Netherlands in particular. So the coronavirus will hurt the most disadvantaged groups in society even more than ever. And therefore, the most important questions of tonight are, how should we should our governments fight inequality and redistribute wealth? And how should we organize our society in a fairer and more equal way? So I'm really happy that you're both here with us tonight. We will start the evening with an interview of about 30 minutes, and after that there will be questions from our online audience who have sent in their questions already before this evening, and after that there's also some room for questions here from the audience, so think already about what you would like to ask at the end of this program. We will stop a few minutes before 8 because Mr. Piketty has another meeting after this conversation. I would like to start with my first question, Mr. Asscher. What are you curious about? What would you like to hear from Mr. Piketty tonight?
Well, thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Thanks so much for joining us. I think your work has been quite an inspiration for, you know, the political field in all over Europe and the Western world. And I would like to hear you. I've read that you've written extensively about the effect of shocks on equality in history. And this shock is the biggest shock we ever live in. So I was wondering what you expect the coronavirus to do to equality in Europe and worldwide. And also if you're optimistic about the recovery efforts in Europe, because there's a Euro summit by the end of this week. We had a parliamentary debate about it in the Netherlands today. And I sometimes worry that it's a lot of money, but will it help to prevent an increase in inequality? So I hope you can shine your light on that. Yeah. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah. And Mr. Piketty, what are you curious about with regard to Mr. Asscher? What would you like to hear from him?
Well, you know, first of all, let me say, you know, I'm very glad to be here for this discussion. You know, of course, the Netherlands are a very important country in Western Europe and in our collective effort to improve our economic system and our social model in Europe. So I'm very, very glad to have this opportunity to discuss, and, you know, especially in the current European context. You know, I've been working on the history of inequality over time across societies, and one of the big lessons from history is that there are always different ways to organize an economic system. You know, the idea that for a given level of economic development or technological development, there will be only one possible economic policy and one possible level of inequality or structure of inequality is just wrong. You know, when you observe the evolution of inequality across societies over time, you see major changes. And sometimes some of these changes, you know, as you suggested, you know, can be prompted by big shocks like the kind of shocks we have today, but more generally financial crisis, social conflict, and other shocks, you know, make a dominant view about the way the economy is organized change sometimes much more quickly than what people imagine. And I think, you know, if you look at inequality from a long-term perspective, what's striking is two things. You know, first, in the long run, there is a decline in inequality. So, you know, European societies today, either in the Netherlands or in France, are more equal than a century ago. And this was a huge success historically. You know, it did not happen just like this. You know, it happens through the development of social security system, of free education, of progressive taxation of income and inheritance. And this has been a big success historically. The second point is that in the recent decade, you know, in the recent period, since the 1990s, 2000, you know, you have a trend going in the other direction of rising inequality. We are not back to the level of the early 20th century, far from it. But we should be careful, you know, not to continue in this direction, because I think, you know, this is, well, first, this is not good for economic prosperity, because in fact, historically, what has been good for economic prosperity is actually a move toward equality, and in particular, equality in education, equality in access to fundamental goods like health. You know, we've seen in this crisis how it's important to have a good public health system, and we need to make progress in this direction. And we need to have, you know, more equal societies historically has also been associated with higher economic performance. And the rise of inequality in the past two or three decades did not bring more growth. It didn't bring more growth in Europe. It didn't bring more growth in the United States, where growth rates have been divided by two since the 1980s. So, you know, you have more concentration of wealth at the top, more concentration of economic power. But, you know, the view that this was supposed to bring more innovation, more growth, it could have been right. You know, like every ideology, it is partly plausible. And I try in my work to, you know, to give a chance to these different ideologies. But at some point, if you look at the evidence, you know, I think, you know, it didn't work. And I think this is why today we are at a juncture, you know, because a big part of the middle class and the lower socioeconomic groups in Europe and in the United States is very skeptical about the economic system in general and globalization in particular. And so you have the nationalist response, which is very strong, stressing the return to the borders, to the frontiers, to national identity. And, you know, I think there's a risk after this crisis that this discourse will become very strong. And then on the other side, you know, I think it's important to imagine a different economic system on a different basis than the nationalist ideology, on the basis of more equality, redistribution. And, you know, I think more investment in education and health is very important. More progressive taxation is very important. And I think, you know, the debate about the wealth tax and the progressive wealth tax, which I know, you know, you're having in the Labour Party in the Netherlands, you know, I think is very important. I think moving in the direction of more progressive taxation of wealth, you know, is part of the solution in order to bring more public revenues to invest in education, to invest in public hospital, to reduce taxation also for the poorest economic group and the lower middle class, you know, which have had a big increase in many countries in taxation in the past 20 years, partly because the very rich were escaping from taxation because of countries competing with one another. And so,
yeah, maybe this,
you know,
is a good point
to, we can, you know, in this discussion, talk about this, because of course the Netherlands has at the same time a very, very high performing social model, and at the same time it's also a highly performing tax havens in certain dimensions. And so I think it's a part of the contradiction that we have to solve today in Europe.
So one of the big issues you mentioned is that we should reform the tax system, right? And I am wondering, Mr. Asscher, what are your ideas on this? Do you have any concrete measures that you would like to address in your election proposal?
Yes, I think one of the problems Mr. Piketty has helped us understand is that we have always been quite successful in trying to keep down income inequality in the Netherlands through progressive income tax. But wealth taxation is not so progressive in the Netherlands, and the inequality has risen enormously. So I think there's two problems we need to address. The first one is the one Mr. Piketty mentioned, of big corporations not paying their taxes. The Netherlands has been quite successful in helping them not to pay their taxes. Mm-hmm. We've just seen in recent weeks the decision by Unilever to go to London instead of the Netherlands. But it was the end of a pathetic competition between the Netherlands and the UK to get Unilever to choose their country, and mm-hmm. offering lower and lower and lower taxes that, of course, had to be paid by the employees mm-hmm. of Unilever in the end. So I will propose a European level corporate tax, a mm-hmm. minimum level, which isn't there, but this will help to stop the race to the bottom.
What would be this minimum percentage?
I would say at least 25%. And for the Netherlands, we should aim higher. It used to be much higher. And second, when it comes to wealth, I think we need a new system for wealth taxation for individuals, which is progressive. So the people who have, you know, been saving for their old age, you should, you know, help them up to a level of 60,000 euros to not mm-hmm. pay wealth tax. Mm-hmm. But then it should go up at 1% until 100,000, at 2% for the next step, up until 5% for everyone owning more than mm-hmm. 5 million euros. If we would do this, and if we would be successful, mm-hmm. this will be in our manifesto for the upcoming general election, mm-hmm. that could enable us to collect, we will have the central agency try and check how much it would be, but over 2 billion euros to invest in wages, to invest in lowering taxation for workers, to invest mm-hmm. in the public sector. Mm-hmm. So it's extremely important, because the Netherlands is affected by the coronavirus, and the coronavirus economic crisis will increase inequality, increase despair, the cynicism and the skepticism about the economic model and the political system we live in. So we have to respond by presenting more radical proposals mm-hmm. to change that.
Yeah, so you just mentioned already two quite radical proposals, I can say. Mr. Piketty, how are you listening to these proposals? What do you think of it? Are they radical enough or too radical?
Well, you know, no, I think, you know, I very much welcome and support this kind of proposal. Maybe we can come back later to the issue of the European tax harmonization and the European recovery plan, which I did not really answer about in the first question, but beginning with the wealth tax proposal so if I understand well, the proposal that you're putting on the table in the name of the Labour Party of moving toward a system with a lower tax at the bottom, you know, for people who have relatively low wealth, and higher tax rate for people who are, you know, multi-millionaire or people who have dozens of millions, mm-hmm. up to 5% for the highest wealth level. You know, I think this is going in the right direction. And I think, I think that's very important from an economic viewpoint, but I think also from a political viewpoint, this is a kind of proposal that can contribute to make a new kind of coalition. I don't want to interfere in your discussion with other political parties in Netherlands, but, you know much more than I do about this. But, you know, I know that the Netherlands, like in France today, you know, has many political parties, very dispersed electorate, especially on the left-hand side of the political spectrum. And I think in order to bring together some of these parties, I think it's important to have some strong and new proposal. And I think more progressive taxation of wealth can be part of this proposal. And I think, you know, the world is changing with respect to this kind of proposal. Let me tell you a personal anecdote. You know, I 6 years ago, when I wrote Capital in the 21st Century, I remember I had a public meeting with Elizabeth Warren in Boston, and at the time, you know, she was very skeptical about the wealth tax. You know, she was saying, oh, maybe that's too radical. And you know, 4 years later, you know, she was competing with Bernie Sanders, and both were sort of competing as to who was going to propose the biggest wealth tax. And, you know, they didn't win the primary, but first, you know, they got a huge majority of the vote for all voters below age 50. So, you know, that's already something important. And in any case, you know, their specific proposal of creating a wealth tax has a huge majority support, not only in the Democratic electorate, but also in the Republican electorate. And recently there were polls also in Britain, you know, showing that the idea of a millionaire tax was very popular. In Germany, you know, I had a very interesting experience also, you know, 6 years ago, at the time of my previous book, you know, I went to Berlin, I had a public meeting with SPD officials, and, you know, Sigmar Gabriel at the time, who was a vice chancellor, you know, told me, you know, wealth tax is dead. You know, we will never reintroduce a wealth tax. We will never support a wealth tax as a party, SPD. You know, I came back to Berlin just after the lockdown, you know, in February this year. I had discussion with, you know, Olaf Scholz, with the new SPD vice chancellor, with the SPD leadership, and they are all competing, including, you know, in their discussion with Die Linke and other parties on the left about who is going to propose the biggest wealth tax. So, you know, I think public opinion is changing about these issues, not only in the Netherlands, but, you know, in the US, in Germany, in Britain, in you know, in France, certainly people were very upset by the way, you know, Macron, you know, increased taxation on lower income groups in order to pay for the repeal of the wealth tax. And this was very much at the origin of the Yellow Vest movement 2 years ago. So, you know, I think there's a very big social demand for more economic justice.
You know, think François Hollande was too...
After this crisis, you know, we need to hear this.
Do you think François Hollande was too early with his proposals at the time? Because that met with a lot of criticism.
You know, François Hollande was not so clear in his proposal because his 75% tax rate was not very clear. It's not clear whether he wanted to apply it to all incomes or to a specific group. So, regarding the wealth tax, I think he was very, very shy. You know, there was it's an interesting issue because when we think of reintroducing a wealth tax, you know, in France or in the Netherlands or in Germany or in the US, I think it's important to do it much better than the way it was done the previous times. In particular, you know, one problem with the French wealth tax is that people could report basically anything they wanted in their wealth tax declaration, in the sense that there was very little control and there was no pre-filled wealth declaration, basically. So people had to put themselves what they own. Whereas for income taxation, you know, it's all automatic, you know, so anybody with a wage income, you know, and including, you know, very low wage, you cannot cheat. You know, it's already in your declaration of income and you have to pay. That's it. But for the wealth tax, somehow, you know, you could put whatever you want. And if you have a random control, then maybe there's a problem. But most of the time, there was no control. And, you know, there was this famous story with this budget minister of François Hollande, Jérôme Cahuzac, you know, who had a bank account in Switzerland. And you know, he was in charge of making people pay tax in France, but himself had a bank account in Switzerland on which he was not paying tax. And he thought, you know, he believed that he could do away with it, that nobody would discover it. Mm-hmm. And even after this scandal and this terrible affair, which happened right at the beginning of the Hollande mandate, they actually, you know, they should have reformed the wealth tax so as to have an automatic transmission of information from banks to tax administration, you know, including at the international level. But they did not do that. You know, they did not change the basic functioning of the wealth tax. So I think, you know, there was a lot of missed opportunity, which, you know, brings me also to another important point, is that, you know, social democrats have already been in power in the past. I mean, they've been in power in the past, either alone, like in France, or in coalition, like in Germany, or in the Netherlands, in the case of your party. And I think it's very important to explain, you know, why this is going to be different next time. And so, mm-hmm. you know, it's, I mean, I'm not saying that to be mean with you, you know, I think it's,
asking
you this question. And I think that's why, you know, this proposal that you're making today, I think is very important, because it's a way to say, okay, we have new ideas on certain issues.
But I think you are making an interesting point here. And I think that's also what a lot of people who are watching are maybe thinking. The Labour Party was part of a government in which the neoliberal order actually was strengthened instead of generating more equality. What are you going to do in the coming period in order to counter that narrative?
Well, I'm glad you call it a narrative, because that is a narrative. I think at the former crisis, the first big discussion was whether the stock owners would also pay for what happened, or if every, you know, bill would go to the middle class and the lower income groups. And that was a fight in which I think Jeroen Dijsselbloem was very important. I know he's hated in some parts of Europe, but he said, we cannot bail out all the banks and the financial institutions if the stock owners themselves will not be part of that mm-hmm. solution. And by now, that narrative has changed, and everybody accepts that that is the fact. But mm-hmm. until that moment, they had just a free ride, and you know, the taxpayers would pick up the bill. I think this time around, and Mr. Piketty has been quite important in changing the narrative and the discourse on this issue. I think by now the only way to really change it is if all parties from the left work together mm-hmm. in making the argument that it's a matter of fairness and just taxation, that millionaires will pay their share, stock owners will pay their share. So there have to be serious proposals. If they're not substantial enough, they're only symbols. If they are too radical, mm-hmm. they will not be, you know, really introduced. And if they're easy to evade, people will not see that they're adding to fairness to society. Yep. So I think the only way to actually change this in a world where, in economic crisis, some people will you know, put their faith in populist parties, like in France, same happens here. Some people will vote for a neoliberal or conservative parties. The only way to change it is to work together with all parties on the left and demand for wealth tax and corporate tax mm-hmm. to be on a level which is fair.
Yeah.
And that is difference, because I think the example of Elizabeth Warren is a good example of how the discourse has changed.
Yeah.
And that shows that not only the general public is ready for more progressive wealth taxation,
yeah.
but also politics are ready to really introduce it.
Yeah, I'm curious because Mr. Piketty described how the world is changing into a different narrative. But how is it? How likely do you think it is that these kind of ideas will be accepted here in the Netherlands?
Well, there's a big clash now. The current centre-right coalition, led by Prime Minister Mark Rutte, is still proposing, in the middle of this enormous crisis, to lower corporate tax next fiscal year with mm-hmm. 2 billion euros. This is corporate tax going to the big corporations that still make profits. It's not mm-hmm. to help the companies that are in trouble, mm-hmm. but it's, you know, another handout to, and our corporate tax is already on a very low level because we are in competition with other countries. Yep. So this shows a complete disconnect by the current leading coalition with what I think people demand and expect. It shows that it's going to be a big political fight. We've said with the parties on the left that we will not support the budget for next year if it doesn't, you know, go off the table. Mm-hmm. But that's going to be a big fight, because there's a lot of support for the government because of the crisis and rally around the flag effect. But this has to change, because mm-hmm. people feel that, you know, workers on flexible hour contracts were already fired, self-employed are without income right now, to use that moment to hand out another 2 billion, it's just completely unacceptable. And it shows how difficult it's going to be to convince other parties to accept a more progressive, more serious wealth taxation. But it should be part of the election fight itself, of the campaign. Other parties will have to answer, you know, why they think it's just to not ask millionaires to pay their share.
Yeah, and maybe this is also a good moment to go to the first point you made about the idea to increase European corporates taxation. So to have a minimum taxation for businesses. And I think one of the reasons that Mark Rutte tries to lower the taxation here is in the Netherlands is to make it attractive for companies to locate here in the Netherlands instead of leaving to the UK, for example, which we saw last week. How likely do you think this will not happen when we're trying to find a European solution for this? So won't you be afraid that corporations will still leave to the UK or to the US or to Panama or?
Well, of course, but this is always the argument. So Mark Rutte says, well, I think it's a good idea, but we need it should be on the OECD global level. So we just wait until everybody in the whole world agrees, and then it will just never happen. I think we can. We have to be very serious about it. So I think in the trade agreement with the UK, which is being negotiated right now, there have to be very, very strict measures to prevent this competition from happening. Because I think, you know, British workers will pay for it, Dutch workers will pay for it, French workers will pay for it. And it's very serious. It's happening right now. It's the Boris Johnson agenda. On our part, we have to stop our government here from, you know, trying to lead this race to the bottom. We've seen in this country a proposal to abolish dividend tax in another attempt to become more attractive to headquarters. And I think if you look at it from the perspective of workers and forget that some workers are working in Belgium, France and the Netherlands, they are really paying these handouts. So we have to accept, and this is a taboo subject, that you need some European competence on taxation, because otherwise you would just destroy the European project or the progress part of the European project. So you need a minimum level of corporate tax in Europe to stop the race to the bottom, and then you get, a more balanced debate on what is a fair amount of corporate taxation. Should it be 25% or 30% or 35%? What is a fair level? Your second point, sorry, is that what will happen at the borders of Europe? I think we need to also start the discussion of some tariffs, even though it will be called protectionism, when it comes to carbon, or when it comes to corporate taxation, for other blocks that want access to our market, because we don't want them to have an advantage if it's not based on the quality of their product, but if it's based on that not paying taxes or not helping to save the planet.
And Mr. Piketty, what do you think on the possibilities of the European Union in this regard?
Well, you know, I think we cannot continue the economic system the way, you know, it has been organized recently, and in particular in Europe. And you know, I don't think we will have free trade forever without any common taxation and common regulation. So, you know, if the UK or any country, you know, wants to have a zero tax on corporate profits, and if another country, you know, the Netherlands or France, you know, wants to have, you know, 25 or 30% tax on corporate profits, if you want to continue to trade with Britain, you know, at some point you have to say, well, look, you know, the companies that are based in Britain, they have a tax deficit. You know, they don't pay this 30% tax or 25% tax on corporate profits that they pay when they produce in the Netherlands or in France. So now, if you want to export your goods and services to my country, well, you know, you're going to have to pay this tax deficit on the basis of your exports. Now, the difference, the key difference with standard protectionism is that if Britain raises their corporate tax to 25 or 30%, then the tariff will disappear. So this is more, you know, an incentive-based tariff, if you want. You know, it's saying, okay, I don't want tariff, you know, I want free trade, but I want free trade with an equitable tax system. And I want to put incentives on you so that you move in this direction. And I think we're going to have to go to something like this, not only with Britain, but also with other countries in the world, but also inside Europe. You know, if there are countries in Europe that don't want to move to majority rule over taxation in order to have a common tax, because, you know, that's the key issue. Yeah. You know, as long as we have unanimity rule over taxation in Europe, you know, we will never have a, you know, unanimity decision to have this 25% minimal tax.
This is an important point, the point you make, right? That we should go to a majority rule. And this is also my question, how likely is this going to happen? How easy is it to get this done?
Well, I think it's not so complicated for subgroups of countries to do it. You know, what's difficult is if you want to wait for the 27 countries of the European Union to agree. But I think this is a mistake. I think, unfortunately, we have to make progress with a small group of countries that are ready to do it. And I very much hope that, you know, the Netherlands, with a different government, will be ready to go in this direction. But in any case, you know, I think even if it's only France or Germany and Italy, you know, at some point, a small group of countries will have to move to this common corporate taxation. And I think other countries, I think in the end, everybody will join this. But in order for this to happen, you need a group of countries, you know, including Netherlands and Belgium and, you know, as many countries as possible. But you cannot wait for unanimity, because otherwise, you know, it will never work. So, you know, let me mention, you know, there was one very simple bilateral treaty that was signed last year by France and Germany, where France and Germany created a parliamentary assembly between France and Germany, where you have 50 members from the French National Assembly, 50 members from the German Bundestag, coming from all political parties. They meet in Strasbourg, where, you know, there's an empty parliament in Strasbourg, so why not use it after all? And now, the only problem with this treaty is that, in fact, this parliamentary assembly has no real power so far, but France and Germany could have very well decided, well, first to open this to the Netherlands, to Italy, to Belgium, and to give to this parliamentary assembly the power to vote a common corporate tax, a common corporate tax base, you know, without waiting for the unanimity of other countries to agree. Because, you know, I think even if we were to move to majority rule within the Council of Finance, Minister of Finance or Council of Head of State, I think it would still not be fully democratic, because, you know, this Council of Head of State and Council of Minister of Finance, as you know, they meet behind closed doors. We don't know what are the discussions about. You know, they tell you in the middle of the night that they have saved Europe for the 20th time in 10 years, but you realize the next day that they don't even know themselves what they have decided. You know, it's a crazy way to organize democratic decision making. So I know we are accustomed to that in Brussels, but in fact it's not working. And I think, you know, the current recovery plan, which you asked me about at the beginning, you know, I think in principle it could be good to have a common debt in order to invest in the future. But I think it's very difficult with the current decision-making system, you know, based on unanimity rule, to have a transparent democratic discussion about what we're going to do with the money. Is this really going to be invested where it should? How are we going to repay the debt? You know, it's a very strange system where, you know, you decide through unanimity, but in fact, you know, with the big countries putting a lot of pressure on the smaller countries in order to get unanimity. So you decide with a sort of strange unanimity that you have a common debt. And then you say, okay, 10 years later, 10 years from now, we will also try to decide by unanimity of what kind of common tax we can create in order to repay this public debt. You know, this is a, you know, we have a lot of imagination in Europe about, you know, imagining new, but this is really, I think, a bit crazy. I think it would be much simpler to have, you know, a parliamentary assembly with majority rule decision making, with representatives from each country, from each political groups in each country. Mm-hmm. And I think today there will be a majority. You know, if you take the public opinion in France, in Germany, in Belgium, in Italy, in Spain, in the, I think there will be a majority, at least in the Eurozone, to, you know, to move ahead with a common taxation and a more fiscal justice. Yeah. Another possibility would be to give all the power to the currently existing European Parliament, but I don't think, you know, nation states of Europe, you know, they need to be represented in the decision making of you know, about fiscal issues, because, you know, this is really the sort of the very basis of national sovereignty. It's about taxation and budget. So I think you want to involve the nation states through their national parliament, you know, by having national parliament members from each country, rather than simply through their head of state and finance minister.
Yeah, so you actually say that a few countries should take the lead in this and should find each other and to start experimenting with it. I'm happy that we have a politician here at the table who might win the elections next year. And I'm wondering, will the Netherlands, if you win the elections, will the Netherlands be part of that group that is going to take the lead in this?
Well, I would definitely raise corporate tax up to a level which is fair to society. So if we can build an alliance of more progressive governments with social democratic prime ministers and Green Party and Socialist Party, then you could build a bloc like that. However, I'm much more pessimistic about whether there's a majority in Europe right now. I think we've come a long way from the time of your conversation with Elizabeth Warren, but right now there's a big, you know, big fight to be fought first before we can, you know, build parliamentary majorities to get there. Mm-hmm. And I think we can, and we should have that fight. But right now, if there would be a parliamentary assembly, I wouldn't know. And the thing that worries me, that's why I asked about the recovery fund, is that what I see in the Netherlands as well, but also in the United States and all over Europe, is that the recovery funds or the recovery projects might end up in the hands of people that don't need it, while we leave out big parts of our. As an example, one of the first companies that was a beneficiary of the Dutch program was Booking.com, which is a corporation that helps keep down little hotels and restaurants all over the world, and had paid 8 billion euros to their stock owners the year before they asked us taxpayers for help. And at the same time, I see that many people are, you know, left behind. And that's a political choice. So I would, you know, I would be ready to form a coalition with countries within Europe to change this. Yeah. But we cannot afford to wait for it. And at the same time, we have to be, I think, much more critical on how the support programs work out. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise they will not rescue jobs, but rescue stock owners and increase cynicism instead of restoring hope.
Yeah. Because if you look at the Netherlands, for example, 75% of the people is still supporting Wopke Hoekstra in his vision on the European funds, right? So I think it's also interesting to look at how the Dutch people are actually quite critical on European support funds.
Yeah, I think there's two explanations. First of all, the lack of transparency and democracy aspects Mr. Piketty mentions make people suspicious about Europe. Second, I think it's also a result of Dutch politicians not telling the truth about Europe, not being honest about the retiring age of Italians, not being honest about the benefits the Netherlands is receiving from being in this internal market, not telling the truth about the tax haven we have come to be. And then it's always easy to, you know, to blame the others and say, well, they should pay for their own. I think That's quite a dangerous path, though. You know, you've seen in the UK that if you keep telling everything that's a problem comes from across the channel, at the end people will mm-hmm. believe you, and then you end up on your own. Yeah. Well, yeah. This country, the Netherlands, definitely will be much more successful as part of a European Union. And we need to put our efforts to change that union, make it a more social union, make it a more progressive union, instead of, you know, going the easy way and blame our own problems on Brussels or on Italians.
Yeah. But if I'm understanding it right, you are still saying that we should look at the EU instead of looking at other progressive countries in the EU to start with, in a faster pace.
I think it will happen if there will be a wave of changing governments that will have this effect of, you know, countries not accepting this race to the bottom anymore. But what we need is one arrangement all over Europe. What we need is one minimum level, clarity. Mm-hmm. What we need is a clear message to corporations. We welcome you here. Mm-hmm. We're proud of you. We love the fact that you're making products mm-hmm. or services, but this is a society where everyone has to pay a share. Mm-hmm. And that, as long as we are not ready to tell that message, and I think something is changing also, if you look at the language from the European Commission, Mr. Moscovici started with this, and the new commission, at least in language, is also being more vocal about this. Mm-hmm. We should support that. And I think it's a group of countries is a second best option, mm-hmm. But will not have the same effect. Right. But that's my opinion.
Yeah. And we don't have to agree on everything here tonight.
No. So
I'm happy there is also some discussion. I just have one final question before I wanted to go to the questions that have been sent in before this evening. But this is a question for you, Mr. Piketty, because you are quite critical on the behavior of social democratic parties in the past decades. And I read that you state that they have started to supporting from parties supporting the disadvantaged groups in society, they have become parties for the winners of globalization. And I was wondering, what would you advise a social democratic party in the Netherlands to do differently from now on?
Well, you know, first of all, you know, in my book, I try to analyze, you know, in a balanced manner, you know, this long historical evolution where indeed social democratic parties, you know, lost the confidence of the lower socioeconomic groups. And I try to come with different explanation. And I think, you know, it's not that they have abandoned the poor, but it's mm-hmm. it's a bit more subtle. But it is true that social democratic parties over time, you know, I think have been unable or reluctant, you know, to renew their redistributive platform in order to, you know, to convince the poorest group in societies that they had solution for them. And I think in particular the issue of Europe and the issue of how you organize globalization is absolutely critical. And I think it's important to have, I guess my biggest advice would be, it's important to have plans, you know, in advance of what, you know, social democrats and the left want to do with Europe and with globalization. And we cannot just, you know, a coalition of the willing and a coalition of progressive government, of course, is useful, but we already had in the past, you know, times when there was at the same time, you know, a socialist government in France, a social democrat government in Germany, a labor government in Britain, and nothing really happened about how to reorganize corporate taxation in Europe or how we regulate global capitalism in general. You know, you had a move toward the free capital flows without any regulation. So I think it's important to have concrete proposal on how we have, for instance, majority rule decision making about taxation and redistribution in Europe, so that at least if there is a majority for that, then we'll be able to adopt you know, a common wealth tax in Europe, a common corporate tax in Europe. Because, you know, if we don't even have the institution and the majority rule in order to adopt this, you know, then this will never happen. And, I think with my proposal, the worst things that can happen is that the common assembly and the common majority rule system will not adopt a common wealth tax or a common corporate tax. Then each country will just continue to do what can be done, and a lot can be done, you know, at the country level. This is the worst that can happen. But at least we create a democratic tool so that if there is a majority for that, we will move in the direction of more redistribution. And actually, I am more optimistic than you are. You know, I think the problem is not the people. The problem is the institution. You know, I think the people, generally speaking, are good. And sometimes the institutions are bad and do not allow the people, you know, to do what they want. But I think, you know, even center-right politicians, you know, would prefer to have a tax system with a lower tax rate on small and medium-sized companies than on large multinationals. And the only reason why politicians are playing this stupid game, like in the Netherlands, of always cutting tax on multinational, cutting tax on multinational, is because they play their own game on their own, you know, at a one-country level. But if they were part of a common assembly to vote a common corporate tax, not only for the Netherlands, but also for Germany, for France, for Italy, then the same people could take a different decision, because then they would realize that it's impossible, you know, just for Netherlands to get. Let me mention one number. You know, according to estimates made by Gabriel Zucman from Berkeley University, the Netherlands right now is getting each year, year after year, an extra tax revenue of €9 billion per year of corporate tax revenue, which in fact does not correspond to any real economic activity that's taking place in the Netherlands. And that is just basically being taken away from other countries. Now, I don't know if this is the definition of being a frugal country, but all I can say is that this is not a solution for every country. You know, if we all do that, you know, what are we going to do? Is this the model that we have for Europe in the long run? And, you know, this is not going to work very much longer. I think, you know, the public opinion in many countries in Europe, you know, including in my own country, you know, is very upset against Europe, globalization, everything. You know, very often it's very confused, you know, the way people are upset. So it can go in every direction. It can go in the direction of Brexit. It can go in all sorts of directions. Let's try to put, you know, all this anger into the right direction of building, you know, more equitable economic system. And I think, you know, the Netherlands has, of course, a very big role to play in this direction, you know, especially people from the left.
Maybe just a quick response. I think I agree with you on being optimistic about the people. Because people will not accept this unfairness much longer. So there I agree. What I see is that the center-right has been quite stubborn in you know, stopping those efforts, framing them as not in the national interest. So we need to find a way to change that. And there's different ways to do that. I also agree that we need to have plans ready on changing the way we make trade agreements, on changing the way labor migration works in Europe, because it's become a model to keep wages down instead of supporting free movement, and changing the way of we tax our corporations. But I think social democrats, they built the welfare states we are enjoying right now. So we also need to be able to learn the lessons of the past two decades and build a new welfare state, which is also part of a new economic model, and I think the time is ready for it. So I'm quite optimistic about that possibility. And we might disagree on how it should be organized on the European level, but we do agree that we need it at the European level, just to stop this stupid competition between the Netherlands and Belgium, for example, which is completely irrational. Maybe a final point. We also need the power of well, say the revolution we see in France now by the healthcare workers saying, well, you were applauding us, you know, at 8 at night, and now we want to see something in return. It's the exact same discussion right now in the Netherlands, where everybody was applauding. So we also need to use this moment, this corona crisis moment, to say, well, if we want to change things, it's not going to come for free. you need to pay better wages for public servants, healthcare workers, teachers, and that means we need to change our tax system. So we also need to grasp this moment and that part of public anger to change the narrative and push back the right on this issue, push them, put them on the defense, instead of explaining that they're just protecting jobs, because they're not.
Since we have only a few minutes left, I wanted to ask some of the questions that have been raised by the online audience before. If we had more time, I would love to dig more into this. But one of the questions that has been sent in is the following. Rutte said in a recent debate that you can't get jobs when you apply Mr. Piketty's IDs. What is your reaction to this?
Well, I obviously disagree, but it's been the way.
But isn't it true that if we increase taxation, companies will leave to other places and we will lose our jobs here in the Netherlands?
When we protested the abolishment of the dividend tax, Prime Minister Rutte said that could cost up to 2 million jobs.
Yeah.
And it was completely irresponsible. And then he couldn't find a majority for it, and it didn't have any effect. So it's a very dangerous, almost populist way of trying to prevent normal, decent corporate tax. We're not proposing anything radical. Mm-hmm. A couple of decades ago, corporate tax was over 35% in the Netherlands. And now we're lowering, up to 20%. Mm-hmm. So it's nonsense.
So you don't see it as a problem?
I see a problem, of course, if you have those border effects. If other countries are, trying to win that same race, there's a problem.
Yeah.
So we need to, have those tariffs at our borders.
Yeah.
But we should not fall for this argument, because it's been the same argument all over again.
And then there is a question actually to both of you. This is Thies Fakkel from Soetermeer, who says, it's clear what the advantages for the lower social classes are when we're implying your theory and your policy proposals. But what are the advantages of such a system for the higher social classes? Because they have to offer part of their wealth in order to make this system work. What is your reaction to this, Mr. Piketty?
Well, I think the higher social groups, in the end, they will benefit from a more equitable tax system as well. Because if they want to keep globalization going, and if they want to keep our economic system going, you need some support to the system. So if they want to end up with Trump and Bolsonaro, they can continue business as usual, and they will end up with xenophobic right in power everywhere, and which is not so good for business in the long run. And also, if we want to solve all the big challenge we need to solve in order to keep globalization going, the rise of inequality, global warming, if we want to address global warming, we have to reduce the current level of economic inequality. So I think even the biggest corporations and the highest wealth owners, should realize this. Now, regarding your prime minister, I cannot. Unfortunately, my understanding of Dutch, is very weak, and so I cannot really understand what he meant by this. I'm not sure. I don't know how much he has read of my book. I hope that he reads books, because I think it's important to read books. Let me simply say this.
He does read books.
Historically, economic prosperity has come with a movement toward equality and more equality, in particular in access to education, in access to workers' rights, to fundamental goods like health and education. So, the view that more inequality is always good for prosperity and that less taxation is always good for prosperity is simply wrong. If you look at the level of the European Union, the countries with the lowest tax level are Bulgaria and Romania. So, if it was enough to have a low tax to be rich, then, Bulgaria and Romania will be richer than the Netherlands and Sweden. So, at some point, it's important, to be a bit more serious about, the real economic and historical factors that make economic prosperity possible and sustainable.
All right, thank you very much. I hope, Mr. Piketty, you have a few minutes left to take one or two questions from the audience.
Yes, or two, but then really have to run, I'm sorry.
All right, okay. Timo is here with a microphone, so if there is anyone who has a question here from the audience, please raise your hand, and Timo is coming to you. I know it seems dangerous to ask a question when you're only here with 30 people, but is there someone with a pressing question? Because otherwise I have a few questions. We're coming to you with the microphone.
So there is also an idea to not have the tax for labor, but have the tax for carbon emissions that companies state. Is that maybe also a better way to reduce inequality for the crisis that we are facing, but also facing our sustainable goals?
Mr. Piketty?
Yes, so in my last book, you know, I proposed to introduce an individual carbon card so that you can, in effect, you know, make it illegal to have a carbon emission above a certain levels, and more generally, so that you can tax at very, very high level, you know, very large levels of carbon emission, and at the same time protect, you know, the people who have a more responsible and more moderate level of carbon emission. So in other words, you need to have a progressive carbon tax, you know, because if you have a flat carbon tax, then you end up with the yellow vest in France, basically, where in effect you are taxing a lot, you know, the people who have their just take their car to go to their work, whereas the people who take their plane to go for a weekend to the other side of the world, you know, they very often they don't pay any of this carbon tax. So I think, you know, we'll have to move you know, in this direction. So, you know, some people say, of course, it's impossible because it's too intrusive, etc. But, you know, these are the same arguments that were put forward, you know, one century ago about the creation of an income tax or a wealth tax. You know, the conservatives were always saying, oh no, this is impossible, this would be very intrusive. And, you know, remember, right now, with our credit card, all banks, you know, they know what we spend every day, and somehow we have learned to trust them that, you know, they will not use the information to do, you know, stupid things with the information. So, you know, the idea that it's impossible to trust the public administration trying to fight against global warming to administer such a system, I think is very conservative and pessimistic. And I think we'll have to move in this direction of, you know, progressive carbon taxation and big reduction of inequality together with a big reduction of emissions, you know, if we want to be serious about global warming.
I'm just looking around if there is another pressing question, and otherwise I don't see any hands here. So I would like to wrap up the discussion with one final question. Actually, Mr. Piketty, we started this discussion with a question from Mr. Asscher about your ideas on the recovery of Europe. And I am wondering, are you optimistic or pessimistic about what will happen to the future of Europe?
You know, I am in the very short run, I am a bit pessimistic, but in the medium run, I am relatively optimistic, because I think in the end, you know, the public opinion in Europe, you know, are very strongly attached to the idea of European unity, of a European social model that is different from what we have in other parts of the world. And I think in the end, we will do the reform that needs to be done in order to go in the right direction. But, you know, at the same time, you know, in my historical research, you know, I try to develop a non-deterministic view of history, where, you know, times of crisis open the way for different possible trajectories and bifurcation. And so, you know, look, after Brexit, you cannot be sure about anything. You know, anything can happen. You know, if all the parliamentary party, like the Conservative Party in Britain, you know, decided to, you know, destroy Europe or their country or both, you know, through a referendum, you know, why wouldn't a new crazy populist party in Italy or in France or in, I don't know, go do the same kind of stupid thing? So, but even if this happened, I don't think this will happen. I am more optimistic than this. But in any case, we'll have to reconstruct something. And so I think in any case, it's a good use of our time, to try to have a very precise discussion about what is the better institutional system for European decision making, what is the better tax system for carbon, for wealth, for education. In any case, we'll always be neighbors, we'll always be, living on the Earth planet, which we will have to save. So, there can be some tough time ahead, but, I think we have collectively to design a better future. And we should not leave economic and financial issues, to a small group of experts, which, sometimes pretend that they have developed an economic science that is so scientific that nobody else can understand. Mm-hmm. And of course, this is a big joke. I think we are in the social sciences, and I think there's a big demand for economic justice, but also a big demand for democratization of economic knowledge and historical knowledge. And this is what I'm trying to contribute a little bit.
And that's what we're doing here tonight as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Nice talking to you.
Yeah, Mr. Asscher, what is your most important takeaway from this evening? Is there something that you've heard tonight, which we will be able to read in your election program next year?
Absolutely. I think maybe the final statement Mr. Piketty made is a very important one. Democratizing the economy, and also making sure that it's not something that is given by God or by nature, but but a matter of choice, a different trajectory is possible. Mm-hmm. That has to be the main message of the election. And yes, we need very precise and serious proposals, policy proposals, and we're working on those. I will be in touch to check and brainstorm on some of those issues, because I think some of the ideas are very interesting. But that the main message is that we live in a society that we have to design ourselves, and that we should not accept the current order as a given, which is, something to be accepted. No, fairness is something social democrats have always strived for. And if you look back one century, we've been quite successful. So we need to aim as high for the next century.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Piketty. Thank you very much, Mr. Asscher. And thank you very much for watching this evening. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Bye-bye.